Okay, hello. We're just discussing Bohm's theory, or the pilot wave theory as it's called, and so that's a surprisingly simple ansatz to obtain particle trajectories, which then, if you average over an ensemble, completely reproduce all statistical predictions of quantum mechanics. And so just let me remind you, the idea is you have a definite trajectory r of t, but at the same time you also time evolve the Schrödinger evolution for the wave function. And you need this because you write the wave function as the magnitude times e to the I, the phase, and this phase is then needed to provide the equation of motion for the trajectory. So the equation of motion for the trajectory will be the velocity at any given time is given by the gradient of the phase of the wave function evaluated at the particle position. With some suitable prefactor which has to be chosen h bar over m. Because if it's chosen like this, then the following holds. If we imagine an ensemble of such particles starting out at time zero, and it just so happens that the density of the ensemble matches the quantum mechanical probability density, this will hold for all times. Psi squared will be equal to rho for all times. So, insofar as measurements are just position measurements, you are guaranteed that all the outcomes, all the statistical outcomes, just match quantum mechanical predictions. Now, we went a little bit further last time. We said, okay, let's say this is my velocity field, V, and now I think of a hydrodynamic situation. So either I can say, aha, my particle moves along the gradient of the phase of the wave function, which means perpendicular to the lines of constant phase. Or else I can think of an ensemble of particles moving along such trajectories. And in order to understand these trajectories, I can imagine that at any given moment in time, I plot the velocity field, like I would do for the motion of water. And so a particle will drift along this velocity field. And then we ask ourselves, so what is the equation of motion for the velocity field? And we found the following: the time derivative of the velocity field plus V times gradient applied to the velocity field equals some acceleration. An acceleration that is given by a suitable force, I will call that F Bohm, because it's different from the Newtonian force, divided by the mass. Now, the left-hand side is very well known to anyone who does hydrodynamics. This just tells you if the velocity field, even if the velocity field is stationary and the first term vanishes, then still particles following these streamlines which bend must be accelerated, obviously. Okay, so this term is the so-called advective term. So the left-hand side really is the acceleration of the particle. What is interesting is the right-hand side. So the Bohmian force consists of two parts. The first part is just the standard Newtonian force. And so if I do have a potential, it's minus gradient of the potential. But then there is another contribution, and let me just write everything in terms of the potential, because to this there is added a term that depends on how the modulus of the wave function depends on position. So let me write it down. This would be minus h bar squared over 2m Laplacian of the modulus of psi divided by the modulus of psi. And so this is different. This is like a new addition to the potential. And sometimes it's called the quantum potential. So now, for a moment, I want to discuss what is the meaning of this quantum potential. And for that purpose, let's just look at an example. And the simplest example we have is, say, the harmonic oscillator. State wave function, for example, is just a Gaussian. So that would be psi of x. And now I would take the magnitude of psi, which is the same as psi because it's real valued, and calculate the quantum potential. And you can do that for yourself as an exercise. What you will find is the following. The quantum potential near the origin is positive simply because the curvature is negative, but then there's this minus sign. Whereas if I go further out, the curvature becomes positive, the curvature of the wave function becomes positive, so this term is positive, and in total the quantum potential is negative. And if you work it out, you find the quantum potential is just an inverted parabola. And so, that's very nice because then the potential, it turns out the potential plus the quantum potential is just a constant. So there's no force anymore. And that matches our observation that if we are in a stationary state such as the ground state, there is no gradient of the phase field, so there's no velocity according to Bohm's theory, so the particle is just sitting there at rest. So there can't be any acceleration, there shouldn't be a force. F Bohm is zero in the stationary state. So that is consistent with having V, the velocity being zero. Okay, and that, of course, not only works for the harmonic oscillator, it works for any example you can think of. So it is a little bit like the real potential would like to make the particles move in towards the center, but the quantum potential pushes against that tendency. And so, at least something qualitatively similar is encountered, for example, if you talk about quantum pressure, if you have, say, a gas of electrons and it's hard to compress. And so that is really what expresses the fact that Heisenberg tells us if we were to compress this wave function, then the kinetic energy would go up because the momentum fluctuations would go up. So all of this is incorporated here. Now, I want to go back to this equation. This already looks like a hydrodynamic equation for a fluid without friction and subject to this force field. If you supplement this with the equation of continuity, which just tells you that the density moves wherever the current density tells it to move, then this is like a hydrodynamic description. And it turns out that this hydrodynamic description, this hydrodynamic way of writing the Schrödinger equation, had been invented a long time before Bohm, and that was in the early days of quantum mechanics due to someone called Madelung. So, again, this equation of motion for the velocity field plus the equation of continuity at the time derivative of the density plus the divergence of the current density field equals zero, and the current density field is just the rho times v. So that had been already discovered by Madelung. So it was his hydrodynamic formulation of quantum mechanics. But the difference is, of course, that at the time it was not clear how to interpret the rho, and Ohm gives it a definite meaning. He says, oh, this rho is due to a lot of particles following specific trajectories. Okay. Now, let's go back to the basics of Ohm's theory. We said that all the statistical predictions of quantum mechanics are obeyed, and that is certainly true as far as measurements of position are concerned, because that's the way it is built. Now, let us think a bit more about momentum, because it turns out, as you can see in these simple examples, if I were to take the situation seriously with my electron sitting at some place and not moving at all, and then I would look at its velocity, the velocity is zero. It's always zero. So also the momentum is zero, so to speak. And this does not match at all the quantum mechanical prediction for example, the momentum fluctuations in the ground state. These are finite. The variance of the momentum has a finite value. So there seems to be something a little bit strange there. So r dot equals v, the Bohmian velocity, is good enough to give us trajectories to fulfill all the correct statistical predictions for the probability distribution and position, but it is not connected at all with the momentum distribution. Zero, but my electron is just sitting there. Nevertheless, if you work it out, at least the following holds, at least on average, the Bohmian velocity matches the average quantum mechanical velocity. Otherwise, for example, the dynamics of wave packets wouldn't come out right. So that you can check yourself. Now still, you might say this is a little bit disappointing. What happens if I measure the momentum distribution? Well, then you have to go back and ask, how do I actually measure the momentum distribution? And the idea will be that in the end, you measure it by, for example, a time of flight experiment, and that ultimately is carried out by measuring positions. So let me just give the example. So we measure the momentum or velocity distribution by a time of flight experiment, which would mean we start with our harmonic oscillator potential and the ground state wave function. According to Bohm, the particle is just sitting there still, but then we switch off the potential, so we suddenly set the potential to zero. And of course, according to quantum mechanics, the wave packet will expand because it's no longer constrained by the potential. And then at some later time, you will simply measure where is the particle. And then you will repeat the experiment many, many times and take the distribution at some later time. And the claim is that then you get completely the correct predictions. You have to get the correct predictions because Bohm will correctly reproduce this probability distribution. I can also draw how the Bohmian trajectories will look like. So, at first, the particle is just sitting here. And then, as the wave packet expands, there will be phase gradients, so the particle will start to move. For example, like this. Then I think of an ensemble of particles. I do the experiment again. The particle might have been sitting at another place. And again, when I switch off the potential, it will start to move. And then if you work it out, you will find such a pattern. And so that means Not only if you measure, say, at this point in time, do you get the correct distribution of positions, but also it even matches the velocity distribution. So somehow here, Bohm's theory would agree with what Niels Bohr tells us, that it's very important to describe the setup in which you actually do the measurement. Okay, so you get the correct predictions. Single particle, but many particles. For example, if I really want to describe a more complicated measurement process, probably I have to go to more particles. Now it turns out the extension is really very straightforward. We just take the many particle wave function, you get a phase that depends on all the positions simultaneously, and then you take the gradient of that phase field with respect to coordinate 1, coordinate 2, and so on. So psi, as you know, in such a situation is a function of all the particle positions at the same time. And, of course, you can write it in terms of modulus and phase. And therefore, the phase is also a function of many positions simultaneously. And so the new guiding equation will be simply that particle position number j changes according to h bar over mj gradient with respect to rj of the phase field. And so then you can go through all the algebra again and convince yourself that if initially the distribution of these configurations, of these many particle configurations, was correct, that is according to psi squared, and the trajectories follow these guiding equations, then also the many particle configurations will be correctly distributed at any later point in time. So this works. And, for example, you can treat many-body problems like, well, the measurement process where you have a system interacting with the many particles in the measurement apparatus. What you will find is that, well, as soon as you have this irreversible interaction of one particle with the rest of the big apparatus, then by way of these trajectories, you really pick one configuration. There's no ambiguity. There's, at least in these trajectories, there is just a clearly defined configuration. So even though, in principle, the many-particle wave function still contains all these different branches that we talked about when we talked about Everett's picture, the trajectories, so to speak, belong only to one branch. This is the branch that has been selected. And it is being selected with the correct probabilities that is built into the theory. Okay. Now, let us have a look at this a little bit more closely. In particular, you might be concerned by the fact that the equation of motion of particle number j then also depends on all the other particle positions. So what does that mean? Well, let's start with a very simple case first. Let's pick a product state. That will be simple. And so if you have a product state, psi 1 times psi 2 and so on, then of course the phases add up. And as a consequence, when you take this gradient with regard to, say, particle number 2, it will only depend on the phase of particle number 2. So that is nice, the trajectories are independent in this state. So you have independent trajectories, as you would expect for a product state. Now, what about an entangled state? Well, then it cannot be written anymore as a product of psi 1, psi 2, and so on. So also the phase function becomes more complicated. It, in general, cannot be written as a sum of different contributions belonging to different particles. And so that means immediately, you do have the situation that Rj, time derivative, depends on all the other positions of all the other particles. Even if, at the present moment in time, there is no physical interaction between the particles. So, that certainly means we have a non-local theory. Or does it? So, I'm putting a question mark here, because as I will explain in a moment, the mere fact that somehow the velocity of one particle is correlated with the positions of other particles need not yet necessarily mean that we really do have a non-local theory. So we have to be a little bit careful here. And in order to appreciate this, let me just give an example. So let's just pick a case with two particles. And I'm drawing the wave function in the configuration space of these two particles as a function of x1 and x2. And maybe it looks like this. It consists of two wave packets. One is moving upwards, the other one is moving downwards. And the point in configuration space that represents our system according to Bohm will then randomly, for example, happen to be in this wave packet. And it will follow the wave fronts and be moving upwards. Or in another run of the experiment, I might have the point in configuration space lying down there and traveling downwards, and so on. So I have this full ensemble. Now, there are different ways of telling the story now. So the first way, if I want to emphasize that things are strange, I could say, aha, look at this. If x1 is moving to the right, then x2 is moving downwards, or to lower values of x2. If x1 is moving to the left, to lower values, then x2 is moving to larger values. So that means something non-local is going on. One particle seems to influence the other particle, even though they are very far apart, even though there is no interaction. So, for example, x3 dot is larger 0 or less than 0, depending on where particle number x1 is placed, whether it's here or there. So you might conclude, aha, this is clearly a non-local situation. But you can also tell the story in a very different way, which makes it look much more harmless. Namely, you can say, oh, well, I know such situations. The particles have been produced in a correlated fashion, such that if the velocity of particle number one was positive, the velocity of particle number two was negative. This happens sometimes. And in other cases, it was reversed. The velocity of particle one was negative and the velocity of particle two was positive. And in each one of the experiments, it was either the one or the other corresponding to the configuration point sitting either in this wave packet or in that wave packet. In that sense, there's no mystery. Yeah? This is just classical correlations. Particle states have been correlated at production such that the signs of the velocities are always opposite. And so then there would be no mystery. And in this context, of course, you remember Bell's theorem, where also we had a situation that some correlations in the measurement results are really not that mysterious if they can be explained by some correlations in the initial state of what you have produced. So we have to be a bit more careful and think a bit more about what would we have to show in order to show that really spooky action at a distance is going on. And so I claim what we really would have to show is the following. We apply a force to particle number one, and then something strange happens to particle two. And if we don't apply the force, nothing happens to particle two. Even though they are separated by a large distance, even though there's no physical interaction between them. If we can show that this happens, then indeed something non-local is going on. So we would have to show that the motion of particle 2 can change depending on what we do, depending on what we choose to do on particle number 1. And so if this is true in the absence of interactions, then it's non-local. And so here, I'm stressing the absence of physical interactions because our theory is really a non-relativistic theory. We just have to imagine they are very far apart, all physical interactions have become very weak. In a relativistic theory, of course, you would immediately argue that even if there are in principle physical interactions, even if they have not yet decayed to zero, still they cannot propagate faster than light. And you would make the same argument. Okay, so our challenge is to construct such a situation. So it's clear from the outset we have to use an entangled state. Yeah? Otherwise we have already proven that the particles move independently. So let us consider a very simple entangled state. So psi of x1, x2, I choose to do the following. Let's say, maybe I first draw the picture. And then we write down the formula. I want to have the following situation if I draw x1 and x2. So x1 is sitting in two wave packets. One of the wave packets is located here, the other there, at minus a or plus a. And then particle x2 is also in a wave packet that is centered around zero, which would be. So the wave packets look like this. Now, this would not yet be an entangled state, because I could write it as a product state of a wave packet of particle number 2, centered around 0, and another wave packet of particle, well, particle 1 being in a superposition of wave packets at these two locations. But if, in addition, I prescribe that this wave packet moves upwards and that wave packet moves downwards, then I have introduced quantum correlations, because then the momentum of particle 2 is positive if particle 1 is sitting at plus a, and it's negative downwards if particle 1 is sitting at minus a. So that's an entangled state. Let me just write it down as a formula. That would be phi 1 of x minus a, that's a wave packet centered here for particle 1, times phi 2 of x 2, times something that gives me a momentum in particle 2 going positive, e to the I k x 2, plus something similar, but now the wave packet at minus a, phi 1 of x 1 plus a, phi 2 of x 2, and e to the minus I k x 2. So this is my entangled state. And now I want to either apply a force to particle 1 or not apply a force to particle 1. And depending on that, something should happen with particle 2. So what I imagine is, I want to create a situation where these two wave packets that are at the moment separated come close to each other again. And that I can do purely by applying suitable forces to particle 1. The force must be such that if particle 1 is sitting at this positive coordinate, it's pushed to the left. If it's sitting at the negative coordinate, it's pushed to the right. And then they will overlap. And then something happens, as you will see. There will be interference when they overlap. Okay. Now before we go on and I tell you how the force should be applied, I still want to draw the probability distribution for particle number 2. That's if you take the square of this wave function and integrate over particle position 1, you get the probability distribution for particle number 2. And so I could draw it, like for example here, and it would just be this probability distribution for a wave packet centered around 0. Okay, that will become important later, because the point will be that this probability distribution of particle 2 will not change, regardless of what I do to particle number 1. But we will see the trajectories do change. Okay. So now I imagine I apply a force, or I apply a force derived from a potential. So what is the potential I want to apply? Well, something like this. Because you see the force is the slope of the potential. And so here I will have a force pointing to the left, here I will have a force pointing to the right. This is exactly what I need. And I can imagine that I apply such a potential in a very short amount of time, but it's very strong, so that I apply a force kick to each of these wave packets, and then they start moving towards each other. That's the idea. And I will now draw the situation sufficiently later such that they are just overlapping. So, just as a cartoon picture, if I plot the probability distribution for particle number 1, it would look like this with these two wave packets, but they are now moving towards each other because of the kick. Now, my claim is that if I take a snapshot at the right point in time when they just overlap, I will get an interference pattern. So how does it look like? Well, psi at this later time looks like the following. I imagine that I can neglect the spread of these wave packets. You can work it out that this will be fine if you arrange parameters correctly.
So I still take phi 2 of x2, nothing has changed in that regard. I will even neglect the motion of these phi 2 wave packets downwards and upwards, even though in principle they of course move due to the momentum. I can neglect that if I'm fast enough, so, and if the wave packets are large enough. But phi 1 of course is no longer situated at a and minus a, but rather just overlaps, sits at the origin.
Okay, so approximately this is phi 1 of x1 times phi 2 of x2. And then there are these two parts, the one part with the momentum for particle 2 moving up, the other moving down. Now there's another momentum that has come into play because I gave this force k. And so also in the direction of particle 1, I will have a momentum, phase vector. So that would be e to the I times kx2, this is this part of the wave packet that was sitting at plus a and it received a force kick in the negative direction. So there's something like minus qx1. Q is the new momentum that my particle 1 has acquired. Plus, and then you can work it out for the other wave packet, both signs of these momenta will be inverted. So it's minus k because that's our ansatz, and plus q because the force kick has been engineered to make it move into the different direction. But now you see, aha, this is just e to the I something plus e to the minus I something, so it's two times the cosine. So let me just draw the situation. This is the interference pattern. Let me just draw the situation. So these wave packets are now perfectly overlapping. That's what I assume. But you see, we really have an interference pattern that can get zero. And if you draw it, for example, if I draw the lines where psi squared would be large, they will look something like this. Ugh. Is that true? No, I'm sorry. So you see an interference pattern. And in a moment I will show that on the computer. First I want to make the point, and we will come back to this, that if I plot the probability distribution of particle 2, that is I integrate psi squared along these lines of constant x2, I will still see exactly the same as before, modulo some motion of x2 that would have been there regardless of the force I applied to 1. So the force applied to particle 1 does not change this probability distribution of particle 2. But does it do something to the trajectories? And the answer is yes. Because we will see this immediately in the numerical simulation, but if you want to read it off here, you will agree that this wave function is completely real. There is no phase gradient. Yeah. Whereas in this situation, there was a phase pattern and the Bohmian particles were moving either up or down. Yeah. So the trajectories of particle number 2 are changed by the force I applied to particle number 1, even though it's light years away. Phase gradient is zero at this point in time, in contrast to what I would have had if I had not applied the force to particle 1. And so that then really proves that Bohm's theory is non-local. and we will see it in the simulation.
So x2 of t changes in response to the force on particle 1, even though they are far apart, and so we would say Ohm's theory is not over.
Okay, and it's very helpful now to just watch the situation develop on a computer. Okay, so what you are looking at here are these two wave packets. Say on the horizontal I have plotted x1, on the vertical I have plotted x2. You can view the whole situation in either of two ways. You can say, aha, these are my two particle coordinates. That's the example I have discussed. I could also say, no, I'm only dealing with a single particle but moving in two dimensions. It would be the same. Okay? Now, as a color scale, I have plotted psi squared, and I've drawn an ensemble of points corresponding to many different runs of the same experiment, and these points are following Bohmian trajectories. And so now in this first run, I will not have an entangled state. I have purely a product state where the momentum of particle 2 is not correlated with the position of particle 1. So in the vertical direction, that is x2, there will be no motion. Everything will take place in the horizontal direction. And what you should then see is how automatically, once these wave packets collide, all these points magically rearrange in order to form the correct probability density. So watch. So now, and of course, since these are wave packets and the superposition principle is valid, they just move through each other. And after they have moved through each other, there is no interference pattern anymore. And you have seen how somehow magically the Bohmian trajectories take care of that. So maybe I show it again. And so at any point in time, if you were to suddenly do a snapshot in a measurement and then repeat the experiment many times, you would get exactly quantum mechanical predictions. Okay. So I can also show you how these trajectories look like. Here I've plotted the position of particle number one, x1, as a function of time on the vertical. And you can see these two wave packets moving towards each other. And then somehow the trajectories moving in funny fashions in order to rearrange themselves so that they produce these density wiggles characteristic of the interference pattern. Also, I should say that the velocities can become very large, so sometimes the numerics has some problems. Okay, now I want to go to the entangled state. So, same setup, but the right wave packet was moving upwards and the left was moving downwards. And you could immediately see that the interference pattern has these tilted lines, just like those I sketched on the blackboard. So, again. So, here, for example, you see the interference pattern. And again, they move through each other because quantum mechanics is linear, so everything is all right. Now, for the second situation, it's interesting to look at not the trajectories of particle 1, those we have already seen, but the trajectories of particle number 2. Remember, we apply a force only to particle 1. And so if you look at these trajectories, again, as a function of time, first you see, okay, there are apparently two groups of particle 2, namely those moving to the right and those moving to the left. That corresponds to what they do in the two different wave packets. But also you see that when they are at the point in time where the x1 wave packets collide, we have this perturbation of the trajectories of particle 2.
And this perturbation is only there because we have applied a force to particle number one. Had we not applied this force, you wouldn't see this perturbation. And so that proves the non-locality, because again, the particles can be very far apart, there are no physical interactions. Okay. So, what I want to briefly discuss now is the fact that although the trajectories do depend on what force you apply to particle 1, the probability density of particle 2 does not depend on the force you apply to particle 1. And that has important consequences, because it means that even though you have these influences seemingly, in observations you can never tell whether someone applied a force to particle number 1 if that is far away. My probability density for particle number 2, which I obtain if I take the full wave function, which is a function of both x1 and x2, and just integrate over coordinate of particle 1, because I'm not interested in that. And so the claim is that does not depend on the force applied to particle number 1. In the absence of interactions. Of course, if there are interactions and you apply a force to particle 1 and change its motion, then indirectly you will also change something about particle 2 because there are interactions. So, the proof is relatively simple. Take a Hamiltonian that is just a sum of the individual particle Hamiltonians, because we assume there are no interactions. And then it's best to take the Heisenberg equations of motion. And so, for example, take any observable A2 of particle number 2 and write down its Heisenberg equation of motion. So the time derivative would be 1 over I h bar, and then the commutator with the Hamiltonian. And now, of course, this commutator would only contain, in the end, commutator of A2 with H2, because it does commute with all the operators pertaining to particle number 1. And so this is true all the time. You could now write this as a possibly complicated function involving only operators acting on particle number 2, and you could at least formally solve these equations of motion, say starting from time 0, and you would find that A2 at time t can be expressed completely in terms of operators working only on particle number 2 at time 0. So A2 of t would be some function of operators acting on particle 2 at time 0. Independent of what you did to H1. So H1 may be time dependent, it contains this force that you apply to particle 1, or you don't apply to particle 1, but this doesn't matter anymore. Yeah? So A2 of t, this function, does not depend on what you did to particle number 1. And so that holds true for any observable acting on particle 2, in particular also if you consider an observable like this, the delta function of x2, the operator for particle number 2, for the position of particle number 2, minus some value x2, then we know that the expectation value of this operator will simply be the density. And so, since that is independent of whatever you did to particle number 1, also the density is independent of whatever you did to particle number 1. This is just a special case. So this proves that indeed the density does not depend on the force. And so, if you were to try to signal anything by applying a force to particle 1 and then watching if something happens to particle 2, All you can do is really measure the position of particle 2 at some point in time, and it will always be distributed according to this probability distribution, and you will never see a difference. Because even if we believe these trajectories, these Bohmian trajectories are there, we are not able to follow them. Yeah? They are just in our imagination as a very useful tool to make things concrete. So, there is no signaling faster than light using these mechanisms. And the influence is solely on the level of the trajectories. Why do I call them unobservable? Simply because if you were to try to observe them, all our discussion from the chapter on measurement would apply, and we would see, of course I can try to measure the point at some time very precisely, but then I will scramble the momentum. If I measure the point at some later time, then I would already have changed the trajectory. Okay, so now all of this should not come as a surprise. You could say that we shouldn't have worked so hard to find out all of this, because if Bell's theorem is correct, then in order to reproduce all the predictions of quantum mechanics, Bohm's theory necessarily has to be non-local, because if it were local, it couldn't reproduce all the predictions of quantum mechanics. So, as a matter of fact, it was when John Bell learned about and looked into Bohm's theory and noticed that it has this slightly embarrassing non-local character that he then tried to find out whether there would be an alternative theory that would get away, that would do away with a non-local character and really be local, and then he found out that this isn't possible. Now, you might be a bit skeptical, since Bell's theorem really makes use of spin. We have the setting of the Bohm's version of the EPR experiment, actually, with two spin 1/2 particles. Bohm's theory, as I formulated it here, does not refer to spin, but there are simple extensions in order to make it work with spin. And these are really very simple, so let me just tell you about it. The idea is, let's focus on a single particle again. It's easy to generalize to several particles. The idea is the following. In principle, then, you know your wave function does not only depend on position, but it also depends on a spin index, which for a spin 1/2 particle would be, say, sigma equals plus or minus 1. Position, there are actually two values of the wave function. Now, still you can define the probability density that does not care about the spin direction. You would say, let me just take the sum over both spin directions of psi sigma. And then total current density by again taking the sum of the corresponding current densities for the two different spin components. So that would be sum over sigma real part of psi sigma star minus I h by gradient over m psi sigma. And then you would find the equation of continuity, etc. And now if your goal is simply to reproduce at all times correctly the position distribution, then you can simply set up the trajectories as follows. To say my velocity field that I will use for my trajectories, I define as j divided by rho. Because I know that if I have a simple drift field and a simple density, j equals rho times b. So I can also use this to define b. And as long as your measurement device can only really detect the presence or absence of a particle, this will give you all the correct predictions. Because the quantum mechanical evolution of the wave function will make sure that all the spin physics is really taken into account. And then this will make sure that at all times you get the correct probability distribution over position. And then, for example, in a real spin measurement like a Stern-Gerlach apparatus, you would of course apply a magnetic field, or a magnetic field gradient even, that would have a non-trivial influence on the spin physics here, but everything would come out right for the trajectories. So that means if you adopt this extension, you can use Bohm's theory to describe, for example, the usual version of the Bell inequality experiment. On top of that, it's not even necessary to introduce spin. Because even for a system which only has continuous degrees of freedom, that is the usual coordinates of a particle, you can engineer situations where effectively you have a two-level system, and then you effectively prepare a spin singlet state. And so let me just briefly describe this. So the experiment I have in mind is actually not really a Gedanken experiment, because it can be done nowadays. And the idea would be the following, and I'll tell you in which physical setup it can actually be implemented. So set up a Bell experiment without spin, without real spin. The idea is to produce an artificial two-level system. And so what I would take is the following. Say both particle 1 and particle 2 are moving in such a metastable potential. And we are looking at the different discrete energy levels of this potential. Now the first level, for example, looks like the harmonic oscillator ground state wave function. The second level looks like the first excited state of the harmonic oscillator, and so on. And the feature is that these very low levels in principle could decay by tunneling, but they are very, very long lived. Whereas these higher levels only feel a very thin barrier, and they can very readily decay by tunneling. And this will become important for measurement. So what you would do now is the following. You prepare your particle in a superposition of these first two states. And then if you want to measure whether it's, for example, in the upper state, let's call that state number 1, and the lower one is state number 0, you would just apply an external oscillating force which matches, for example, the frequency of the transition to one of the higher levels. And so you undergo this transition, but because of the thin barrier, you immediately tunnel decay. And so, provided you have been in state number 1, you will find that the particle suddenly goes to infinity. If you were in state number 0, then the external oscillating force will not match any transition. You will not go to one of the states with fast tunnel decay, and you will stay in 0. So you can clearly distinguish by looking at the trajectory, and this is also then correct for the Bohmian trajectories, whether the particle had been in state number 1 or state number 0. So that is your measurement. Now this is like if I have a spin and can only measure sigma z, for example.
can I then also measure other spin directions?
Well, the idea is you have to manipulate your spin. Yeah? If you can only measure sigma z, then you have to be able to rotate the spin around an arbitrary magnetic field axis, and then you can turn sigma x into sigma z, for example.
And so how can I do this? Well, the idea is also simple. For example, you can turn 0 into 1 by again irradiating the system with a frequency that matches the transition between 0 and 1.
So this is like rotating around a magnetic field that lies in the xy plane and turns sigma z equals minus 1 to sigma z equals plus 1, for example.
And you can also rotate, if you like, around the sigma z direction simply by applying an energy difference, an additional energy difference between 0 and 1, which will be effectively like a magnetic field in the z direction, because now the relative phase difference, say, grows faster than usual. So, measurement would work like this. You take state 1 into one of the higher excited states by irradiating the system, and then this will decay and you will know. And you can also manipulate your artificial two-level system. For example, by having these Rabi oscillations between 0 and 1. Or by applying an additional energy difference. And that can be done simply by applying some extra potential that will change everything. Okay.
Now, in principle, you could probably do this with material particles. Say, if you trap neutral atoms in a suitable optical lattice potential, it might work. But the system where this kind of idea has been implemented and has been perfected are these Josephson superconducting qubits, in particular the so-called phase qubits. Because the idea is then that x would be something a little bit abstract, namely the phase difference of the superconducting phase across a tunnel junction.
People are nowadays routinely applying all these operations and also doing this kind of measurement in these settings.
And so how would you incorporate a Bell experiment, which by the way has been done for these superconducting qubits, although of course they are not very far apart. You would just prepare it in a state that is corresponding to the spin singlet state. So you would prepare 0, 1, minus 1, 0. And there are many ways of doing this. You just need some kind of interaction between the two qubits. That is, of course, clear. Starting from a product state, you need some interaction to create an entangled state. But then you can switch off the interaction, and still you get these strange non-local correlations. And so, for example, just to finish this story, if I were then applying Bohm's theory to this situation, which I hadn't done, but maybe it would be a nice exercise. I could observe trajectories like this. And so this trajectory would mean the following. First, it was looking quite complicated because I did all these manipulations and applied time-dependent driving and so on. But then in the end, what happened is that the x2 coordinate suddenly grew very large, and x1 stayed small, which means I have effectively measured particle number 2 to be in the state 1, which is the one that then goes to decay by a tunneling, whereas particle number 2 I have effectively measured to remain in state number 0. So particle 2 in state number 1. That would be the conclusion. And then if you were to analyze the whole EPR Bell experiment, you would find exactly the kind of non-local influences going on that are needed to violate Bell's inequalities. Okay, so a few last remarks about Bohm's theory before we move on. Well, quite obviously, Bohm's theory is non-local in this sense. Being non-local, it is also not relativistic. Yeah? In order just to make this point very, very clear, imagine the following. Imagine we are doing the experiment that I have described, where we have two particles, one and two, and we apply a force to particle one at some point. And what we have seen is that in response to that force, something visible changes about the trajectories of particle number two at the same time. Now, this is already weird enough because we know in principle in a correct relativistic setting nothing should propagate faster than light, there should not be these non-local influences, also there are no physical interactions. But it becomes even worse if I describe the same situation in a different frame of reference. If I have an observer moving at some velocity with respect to this frame of reference, we know what happens, we know how we should describe the new situations according to relativity. So I should, basically if I draw these space-time axes, I should then view the situation with respect to tilted axes, x prime and t prime, so to speak. So in another frame of reference, x prime and t prime, suddenly what had been simultaneous before is no longer simultaneous. For example, the situation could look like this. So here you apply your force, but of course the change was already before you applied the force. And so that, yeah, that is very strange. And so it turns out people are working on relativistic extension of Bohm's theory. It is actually fairly easy to say, simply take the Dirac equation instead of the Schrödinger equation. But as soon as you have more than one particle, you run into problems. And then it becomes very difficult to define what features should I desire, and what features can I keep. So, extensions are being explored, but nothing definite yet. That is really a challenge. There is another remark I want to make, and that is that Bohm's theory is not unique. You can construct an infinity of theories that will work and give you the correct predictions of quantum mechanics and still have these trajectories. And that is fairly easy to see. Namely, let's stay with a setting like this. We have these trajectories, we have a guiding equation with a velocity, we have a corresponding current density, and we want to reproduce quantum mechanical predictions. In particular, we want that the time derivative of the density that we predict from our theory matches the quantum mechanical density. And so now I just define some B prime from any current density J prime So V prime is J prime over the correct density rule. And this will work out nicely as long as J prime is equivalent in some sense to the correct current density of quantum mechanics. And it need not be equal. All it has to be is that the divergence is equal to the divergence of the quantum mechanical current density, because then the time derivative of the density is equal. So this V prime will also work, provided that the divergence of the difference J prime minus J quantum mechanics is just zero. And so this will work. And of course, then you can construct infinitely many theories. And so that's also not so nice, because you would want to know that even if you can't observe these trajectories, you would want to have a situation where this is the unique theory that fulfills some mathematical requirements, and so you are somehow sure that that is the correct one. Okay. Now then, after Ohm's theory, let me move on to another non-local hidden variable theory, which is in some sense even more surprising and whose trajectories have features that are even closer to what you would maybe imagine, but that depends on your taste. Okay, so the theory I'm about to describe appeared about 15 years after Ohm's theory. Was invented by a mathematician called Nelson at Princeton. And in order to understand it and appreciate it, you should know something about the theory of Brownian motion. So for a lot of the time now, I will just recount many of the things that in principle people like Einstein or Smoluchowski 100 years ago would have known. So, for the time being, forget quantum mechanics. Now, how do we describe Brownian motion? I will not try to be as precise as a mathematician, but we are physicists. We know how to interpret these things. So, let's say at time t, my particle is sitting at point x, and I want to calculate its position at some slightly later time, delta t. I mean, slightly later by delta t. Now, in simple Brownian motion, I will just take a random step. And this random step I denote by delta x of t. Think of a Gaussian random variable with a defined variance and zero expectation value. And we want to assume that this is really independent for each step. At each time step, this is a new independent random value. And so we will assume that the average of delta x is zero. If there were some average, we could just subtract it. But the variance of delta x is not zero. And I have to choose, in order to get a well-defined limit for delta t tending to zero, I have to choose this variance to be proportional to delta t. And the proportionality constant that defines the diffusion constant of this process is 2 times the diffusion constant times delta t. And the limit, as I said, that I want to take in the end is delta t going to zero. That's the idealization. Of course, in any real physical situation, if you look at it very closely, then there is maybe a smallest time for which this model still makes sense, and if you go to smaller times, things change. I can't resist telling the story that once I saw a paper where people took this series down to delta t really tending to zero and effectively concluded, though they didn't state it explicitly, that their particle then moves faster than the speed of light. Okay, so how does the trajectory look like? Well, you start somewhere and it somehow looks like this. So that's a typical random walk. How does the distance with respect to the starting point that you travel scale with time? It does not grow linearly in time, that would be ballistic motion. But the typical distance, of course this fluctuates, but the typical distance grows like the square root of time. So that is typical behavior for a random walk. How would we know? Well, we can just calculate the variance of x of t minus x at time 0. So that's the distance traveled. What's the variance of this? Well, if I take these many time steps serious and then at the end I will let delta t go to 0, this distance is just the sum over the delta x for each of the time steps. Let's call them delta xj. J being summed, so to speak, from 1 to the total number of time steps, which will be given by the total time divided by delta t, the size of a time step. And then I have to square this and average. Now the assumption was that the individual delta x are independent. So in principle, I will get a double sum, which will also contain delta xj times delta xl, but only the terms where j equals l will survive. So then I get a single sum, sum over j, average delta xj squared, and that is, by assumption, 2 times d times delta t. Now, in the sum, there are t over delta t summands, and so I will get 2 times d times t. So the variance, that is, the square of the distance traveled, goes like 2d t. And therefore, the typical distance traveled, you have to take the square root, goes like square root d. So that is probably what you know. Now, if you really let delta t tend to zero, these random processes have a lot of strange properties. For example, if you were to zoom in and zoom in, it always looks self-similar. It's a fractal geometrical object. And as a result, also, you have big trouble defining the instantaneous velocity. So, if we take that serious and try to define the instantaneous velocity, what do we get? Well, we would just be naive and just take the difference quotient, so x of t plus delta t minus x of t divided by delta t, and then I will let delta t tend to zero. Now, according to our equation of motion, this is just delta x of t. And if I like, I can give a new name to that. I could call it v tilde of t. Now, I can calculate the variance of this. In principle, v tilde should also get a subscript delta t because it depends on that. Well, I get the variance of delta x divided by delta t squared, because if I take the variance of lambda times something, there's a lambda squared factor in front, so that's 1 over delta t squared, equals, well, variance is 2 times d times delta t divided by delta t squared. I get something that diverges if delta t goes to 0. So here you have it. If you try to define the instantaneous velocity, it has arbitrarily strong fluctuations. Nevertheless, if I'm bold enough, I can still try to draw a picture of this V tilde, maybe for some not quite zero delta t, and I would just see white noise. Something like this. And indeed, in the limit of delta t going to zero, if you calculate the correlator v tilde of t, v tilde of zero, maybe you first take the discretized form and then you take the continuum limit, you find that at different points in time, these values are completely uncorrelated, but at the same point in time they are correlated. You should express that by a delta function. That would give you 2 times d times delta of t. And here you would then see that this is consistent with the variance going to infinity, because the variance would be evaluating this at t equals 0, and then the delta function at t equals 0 just gives infinity. So that is the white noise velocity field that in principle enters the right-hand side of Brownian motion. So I could have written it like this. I could have said d over dt x of t equals v tilde of t, and v tilde of t would be this white noise. But of course, whenever you are in doubt, and these processes are quite tricky, maybe it's good to go back to the discrete version. So what I now want to add briefly is, if in addition to this random motion, I also have some systematic motion, that is a drift field. People would call that a drift diffusion process. So in addition to this Brownian motion, this diffusion, I have a drift field. And so I would just take the same equation of motion, but get an additional term. So beyond my noise term, I say, well, there's simply a deterministic drift, so a velocity that depends on my current position. Velocity field might also be time dependent, and I multiply that with delta t to get the next time step. So that's the drift velocity. And if I like, I can rewrite this equation in continuum version in differential form. So I would have a noise, that is delta x over delta t, so to speak, v tilde of t, we have called it, plus this drift field. So this will be the systematic motion, and that will lead to diffusion. And so let me just then finish with an example. So if I take v of x to be minus gamma times x, you see this means that whenever my particle deviates from the origin at x equals 0, it wants to come back. And so the result will really be a random process that at short times looks sort of like a random walk, but it can never get far from the origin. The random walk can proceed arbitrarily far because the distance typically grows like square root of t. Here it will never proceed very far. It always goes around the origin. And you can also calculate, for example, what is the width of the distribution, it's the size of these excursions, and you will find that, okay, so this would be the square root of the variance of x in steady state, but the variance of x you will find goes like d over gamma. So the diffusion constant enters. If the diffusion constant is larger, there is more random motion and it will tend to have larger excursions. But if gamma is larger, there will be more tendency to go back to the origin and you will have smaller excursions. And so this is a very famous a drift diffusion process, the most important one. It's called the Ornstein-Uhlenbeck process. And so, for example, it would occur if you have, say, a particle moving in a harmonic potential, but the particle is overdamped because, for example, it's in a liquid. And so, because it's constantly being subjected to the bombardment of all the small liquid molecules, it will execute this Brownian motion, the noise term. But then again, there will always, because of the force that tends to force it down to the origin, there will also be this drift term. And in the end, it will just execute this Ornstein-Uhlenbeck process. And so these things are routinely observed. So that would be the typical setting in biophysics. You have a small marker particle that is bound to some potential minimum. It is in a liquid, and it executes this kind of process. Okay, so see you on Thursday.